In this video, we're investigating the convergence of the alternating series negative 1 to the n square root n sine 1 over n. And we're going to start by looking for absolute convergence. And that means we're testing for the convergence of the series of absolute values, which simply means we ignore the negative 1 to the n out in front. If we can show that this series converges, it automatically implies the alternating series converges, and that's why it's a wise place to start. And one way to approach the convergence of this series is that if you know about power series expansions, the sine function could be written as an expansion so that sine x is x minus x cubed over 3 factorial plus x to the 5th over 5 factorial and so on. And I'll post a link to the video where this was first derived. Well, this means that if x is very small, higher powers of x become negligible, and we get this power series approximation for the sine function, that sine x is approximately equal to x. Well, a small argument is exactly what we're looking at here in the large n limit. So sine of 1 over n becomes approximately equal to 1 over n. And this means the terms of our series become very close to 1 over square root n. Then I recall that 1 over square root n is a divergent P series because the exponent on n is less than 1. And I'll post a link to the video where that was first derived. So that was a decent way to argue the divergence of the series of absolute values, but it's not that rigorous. So if we want to rigorously prove that this series diverges, we're going to use a limit comparison test. And the thing I limit compare to here is the exact same divergent P series that I just found. So what we do is we take our original series, we divide by the terms of the series we're comparing to, which is the divergent P series 1 over root n. And if this limit turns out to be a finite number, then we know the two series share in the same convergence or divergence behavior. Multiplying by the reciprocal of the denominator, I end up with the limit as n goes to infinity of n times the sine of 1 over n. And this is an infinity times 0 indeterminate form. And the way to handle this is to set it up for L'Hopital's rule. Now as n becomes large, this is a 0 over 0 indeterminate form, and we're allowed to use L'Hopital's rule on it. So we differentiate the numerator, and that gives us cosine of 1 over n. And then applying the chain rule, we have to multiply by the derivative of 1 over n, which is negative 1 over n squared. Then when we differentiate the denominator, that's the derivative of 1 over n, which is negative 1 over n squared. Those two factors of negative 1 over n squared cancel out. I arrive at the limit as n goes to infinity of cosine of 1 over n. And as n becomes large, the argument of that cosine function is approaching 0, and the cosine of 0 is 1. So because the limit of the ratio of the terms of those two series came out to a finite number, we know that they share the same convergence behavior. The series we were comparing to was divergent because it's a divergent P series. And we conclude that our series of absolute values diverges. And to state our answer in a really complete way, the original series of absolute values, square root n sine 1 over n, diverges by a limit comparison to the divergent P series 1 over root n. All right, so we don't have absolute convergence, and then we have to go into the alternating series test. And to show that this original alternating series converges, we have to prove two things. First, we need to show that the large n limit of the terms in this series is 0, where that an stands for the absolute value part of the series. Next, we have to show that for n greater than some minimum value, the terms are decreasing. And in practice, number one is always the easy part. So we're going to look at first the limit as n goes to infinity of square root n sine 1 over n. And here we need to use a common trick about the sine function. We're going to use the fact that x is an upper bound for sine x. And I'll post a link to the video where this was first derived. Okay, so the terms in this limit are less than the terms in this limit, square root n times 1 over n. Because the argument of the sine function is an upper bound for the sine function itself. When we simplify, we get the limit as n goes to infinity of 1 over square root n, which unambiguously goes to 0. Well, if the terms in this limit are bigger than the terms in the original limit, and yet the limit still goes to 0, then we're guaranteed our original limit goes to 0 as well. And we're done with part 1. Then we move into part 2, which in practice is the hard part. The standard method for showing that the terms are decreasing is to talk about the function that's generating the terms of this series. F of x is square root x sine 1 over x. And when you evaluate this function at x equals 1, x equals 2, and so on, you're generating the terms of the series. Well, if we can show that this is a decreasing function, then that means the terms of the series are decreasing as well. And the way we do this is to take the first derivative and show that it's negative. So we have to use the product rule. And the derivative of square root x is 1 over 2 square root x. In the second term, we leave the square root x alone and we differentiate the sine of 1 over x. Again, this requires the chain rule. I get cosine 1 over x times the derivative of 1 over x, which is negative 1 over x squared. We'll clean things up a little bit. And I'll go ahead and factor out an x to the 3 halves in the denominator. And now we're trying to figure out if that expression in parentheses is less than 0 or not. And again, we're going to use this upper bound on the sine function. The expression I'm looking at is going to be less than 1 over x to the 3 halves times x over 2 times 1 over x, because sine 1 over x is less than 1 over x, minus cosine 1 over x. And so that argument of the cosine function is just getting closer and closer and closer to 0 as we generate more and more terms in our series. That means the cosine function is getting closer and closer to 1. So our 1 half minus the cosine 1 over x is a negative number. And we've shown that the derivative of our function f of x is less than 0. If that seems a little sketchy, I want to point out for a second that even if I plug in x equals 1, I end up with the cosine of 1. And that's already bigger than 1 half. That's 0.54. And then certainly if I start plugging in larger values of x, I get an even smaller argument on the cosine function. It's getting closer to the number 1. So that 1 half minus cosine 1 over x bit is guaranteed to always be negative. All right, so we're done with part 2 of the alternating series test. Because we've shown that the terms go to 0, and we've shown that the terms are decreasing, we conclude that this alternating series converges. But there's a special name for this because the series of absolute values diverged, and then the series itself converged. It's called conditionally convergent. And we're done. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.